The Doctrine and Covenants contains many well-known revelations. And among these are the 3 degrees of glory and the ministry of the Savior in the spirit world following his crucifixion. There's revelations on the priesthood and the second coming. And within those sections are found answers to many of life's questions. But as you can tell from the title of my presentation for today, what I want to look at is that there's also within the Doctrine and Covenants many less known revelations. And they also contain answers to questions. And the reason I think they're less known is usually they're shorter. In a class, when you're going through them, people skip them. And also, often the people whom they were addressed to are also lesser known within the church. And there are even some, maybe as you've read through the Doctrine and Covenants, you've wondered why that revelation was even in the Doctrine and Covenants. Some have even doubted the value. So what I'd like to do today is examine some of those lesser known revelations, suggest some ways that will be beneficial to us as we study the Doctrine and Covenants, and also go away within a renewed appreciation for the real covenants that were made with real people in the Doctrine and Covenants. And we're going to use kind of a format as we go through with that idea, with each time and discovering who it would be, in dealing with real people, and then searching out what the real covenant was that they made, not only looking at why the Lord would make that covenant with that individual, but the influence that making the covenant had on the individual's life and the lessons that we can learn from it. So to begin with, I like multicolors here, so let's use some of this. I'm going to begin comparing two sections, section 79 and 80. First, if you'll turn there then, we're going to look and let's identify who the people are that are involved in these sections. As soon as you turn, you probably didn't say, I know what those sections are about, because they're lesser known, as are the people that are involved in those sections in looking through. Now, first, let's just notice who the two are to. Main individuals, as you see in verse 1 of section 79, and then verse 1 of section 80, so we have a brother by the name of Jared Carter, 79. And then verse 1, if you've noticed, there's another individual who maybe is also lesser known, Stephen Burnett. Now, both of these revelations are given near the same time, maybe even the same day. They're both calls to serve as missionaries. And yet it's by contrasting the two missionary calls, or calls to service, that the insight is gained from these. So let's just read together here, verse 1. Verily I say unto you that it is my will that my servant Jared Carter should go again into the eastern countries. Now, Jared Carter had just returned from a mission to the eastern countries just a few days before. He'd served there for some 6 months. In fact, he'd returned on the 29th of February. It was leap year that year. You notice that this revelation was given in March of 1832. So within a few days or a few weeks, the Lord is calling him to the same calling again. On the other hand, then, as we look at section 80, dealing with Stephen Burnett, in verse 3, let's look where his mission call was to. Speaking to Stephen, he said, wherefore, go ye and preach my gospel, whether to the north or to the south, to the east or the west, mattereth not, for ye cannot go amiss. Now, that's quite different, isn't it? How would you like to some of you that had mission calls, or open up a mission call that says, you are called to, it doesn't really matter. Just go anywhere you'd like to. This is what happened to Stephen Burnett. Now, the first missionary is given a very specific assignment, and the second missionary is told he can go anywhere. Now, from this, apparently what we see is there are times in life where it matters very much where we serve. And other times, it doesn't really matter where we serve. It matters more that we serve. Now, I've witnessed that as a bishop, that as we pray of callings that should be extended to members of the ward, that there have been times when definitely it didn't matter. I couldn't apologize. In fact, I've visited with other leaders within my ward on that, saying that sometimes you don't get a warm feeling that this is the call that they've been foreordained to in the pre-earth life, because it doesn't matter where they call, they cannot go amiss. I've also experienced that in my own life. I've had bishops call me in and tell me very specifically, for example, as a home teacher, that the Lord wanted me to be the home teacher for a specific family. And I can bear testimony it was very important that I was a home teacher for that family, both for them and for me. And other times when I was actually told, you know, we realize it really doesn't matter what we call you to. You'll do just fine in any calling that you're given. And that was also true as long as I would magnify the calling that I was given. And I've had both in my life. I don't think it's one individual versus another. Now, continuing, I'd like to look at the experience of Jared Carter as he responded to the Lord's call to return to the eastern countries, because it illustrates the importance of serving in a particular area or assignment. And he received that assignment with great enthusiasm. And in his journal, when he had finished with his mission, he just felt he needed to record this. Now, let's see how we do it top here. Focus. There we go. Now, while I make this record, I remember the goodness of the Lord to me in the mission that I've lately been to in the East. I've enjoyed my health continually, and the Lord, notwithstanding the great opposition to the glorious work, has blessed me in this mission in which I've been gone 6 months and 2 days. The Lord has permitted me to administer the gospel to 79 souls, and many others, by my instrumentality, have been convinced of this most glorious work where I've been in this mission. I think there's many a missionary who would trade places with him or go back to the exact same city or the exact same home if they thought in 6 months and 2 days there'd be 79 individuals who came into the Church of Jesus Christ through the waters of baptism and many more who have been touched by his instrumentality. The interesting part here beyond that also is this came because of repeat service in the exact same call that he had had before. The joke goes in the church sometimes if you receive the same call is that you didn't finish what you were supposed to do the first time, so the Lord's giving you a second chance. He had been successful the first time. But the Lord knew that there were individuals that he's aware of their lives, the Lord is, but he's also aware that they may need to serve in the same calling again. And I witnessed that again as a bishop not long ago when, to my surprise, I was so impressed upon to call a Relief Society president for the second time. Imagine being released and so relieved and being told in just a short time that the Lord wanted you to serve in that same calling again. And I'm yet to see all the blessings that'll come, but I know very much that that is the case. Now, as we look here, I didn't continue outlining, but we see that sometimes then as we come into this covenant, there were real covenants made. We can say, if nothing else, the covenant is service. Regardless of where you serve, even if it's the second time in the same calling. And we can benefit from these two short, maybe passed by revelations to these two individuals who blessed many lives because of their service. Now, let's go to another passage here. We're going to look at several. As I mentioned, they're all short. And that's why we need to look at them. Next is section 96 of the Doctrine and Covenants. Look at verses in verses 6 through 9. The section itself is often not looked at, but those verses in particular are. You notice in that first verse, verse 6, that the individual this time is a brother by the name of John Johnson. Pretty common name. And he is told by the Lord that his offering was accepted and that his prayers were heard. Now, just a little background on John Johnson. Prior to this revelation, the prophet Joseph Smith and his wife, Emma, had lived with John and his wife, Elsa, on their farm in Hiram, Ohio. And it was on this farm that the leading elders of the church met together in conference to determine the publication of selected revelations that the prophet Joseph Smith had received, which became known as the Book of Commandments and then later the Doctrine and Covenants. It was also here that Joseph Smith and Sidney Rigdon worked on the Joseph Smith translation of the Bible. Was on that little home of John Johnson, or in that home. And during that time that they received the glorious visions of the celestial and terrestrial and telestial kingdom, etc. Now, the Lord instructed that it was expedient, if we look at verse 8 here, he says, it is expedient in me that he, John Johnson, should become a member of the order. Now, the order that the Lord is referring to is sometimes referred to as the United Order or the United Firm. It was a group of brethren in the church who had united together under covenant that they would consecrate all of the surplus, anything they didn't need for their own family, in their business dealings to provide for the poor and the needy in the church. And at this time, as indicated in section 96, if you look in the heading, let's just read together. So this is a revelation given to the prophet, or to the Joseph Smith, the prophet, showing the order of the city or stake of Zion at Kirtland, Ohio. It was given as an example to the saints in Kirtland. The occasion was a conference of high priests, and the chief subject of consideration was the disposal, or we call it the distribution, of certain lands known as the French Farm, possessed by the church near Kirtland. Now, in purchasing this French farm, there was also a house or an inn. And it's referred to, this little home that Peter French had, the church had purchased this farm. In verse 9, we read, "Therefore ye shall ordain him unto this blessing, and he shall seek diligently to take away encumbrances that are upon the house named among you." So as a member of the order, John is instructed that he's the one to take the encumbrances away. In other words, we've got to get out of debt. Now, this simple passage in the Doctrine and Covenants had a profound influence on the life of John Johnson and the history of the church. John Johnson sold his farm in Hiram, Ohio. Now, this is, as it looked, sometime before 1874. Some of you may be familiar with the John Johnson farm in Hiram, Ohio, and if you've been there, it looks very much the same today. This is the little home that John lived in, where Joseph and others would meet for conferences, and where the Joseph Smith translation was worked on. Had several beautiful other outbuildings that were there. And if you go there, it's evident that it was a beautiful farm, that he was a wealthy man. And the proceeds from the sale of this farm in Hiram were combined with the money of the order to pay for the mortgage on the Peter French farm. It was upon a portion of this land that the Kirtland Temple was built. This temple and resulting blessings, namely the preparatory endowments, which included washings and anointings, many great spiritual manifestations of the temple dedication, the restoration of keys through Moses and Elias and Elijah, were made possible in part because of the sacrifice of this one man's offering. Therefore, what we have is an obscure commandment to an individual not commonly known in the Doctrine and Covenants that shows forth the importance of real covenants made by real people in the 1830s. And further, we have an implication for us today, is that the members who will consecrate their worldly wealth and time may someday receive the same promise that the Lord gave to John Johnson, if you'd like to continue in verse 6, "unto whom I give a promise of eternal life, inasmuch as he keepeth my commandments from henceforth." All right, now let's continue moving through. We may have to use the eraser here and come through. Now, next we're going to look at Revelation section 108. If you look in the heading or in that first verse, you'll take note that section 108 is addressed to that infamous personality, Lyman Sherman. But this section also illustrates a valuable and very personal application for many saints today. Little is known as to why this section was given. And also, unlike the other two sections we looked at, the background in church history really doesn't provide much information. It doesn't tell us why this revelation was given. But it's been as a bishop that I personally experienced those poignant feelings that accompany this revelation. I found that the words of the Lord to Lyman Sherman offer hope to many members of the church who may have been prompted by the Spirit to visit with their bishop because of concerns they have regarding their standing before the Lord. It was due to similar promptings that Lyman Sherman visited with the prophet Joseph Smith and wanted to express his feelings. He told Joseph, quote, "I have been wrought upon to make known to you my feelings and desires, and was promised that I should have a revelation which should make known my duty." And as a result, then, Joseph received the following. Verse 1. "Verily, thus saith the Lord unto you, my servant Lyman, your sins are forgiven you, because you have obeyed my voice in coming up hither this morning to receive counsel of him whom I have appointed. Therefore, let your soul be at rest concerning your spiritual standing." Now, this may not have been the first time that the Spirit had prompted Lyman to go visit with the prophet Joseph concerning his spiritual standing. You notice in continuing verse 2, the Lord admonished Lyman, and resist no more my voice. Now, how long Lyman had been receiving promptings of the Lord to visit with the prophet isn't known. But I think it's very evident that the uneasiness that he had about his soul could have been of a much shorter duration had he gone to visit with the prophet sooner. In like manner, there's those who are members who resist visiting with their priesthood leaders concerning their spiritual standing. Even the Lord, though he's prompted them to do so many times. And how sweet is the solace that comes to that soul when they finally come to the bishop or their priesthood leader to be able to talk to them concerning their spiritual standing. Now, that peace may not come during the initial interview. I found that to be true. But as Lyman Sherman learned, is the individual is able to receive counsel of him whom I, the Lord, have appointed, forgiveness will come. And then additional strength will come as the member follows the further counsel given to Lyman in this revelation, as we continue in verse 3. "And arise up and be more careful henceforth in observing your vows, which you have made and do make, and you shall be blessed with exceeding great blessings." Now, once again, an obscure person making a real covenant, following the Spirit, and receiving a forgiveness of sins and finding is, I can't think of anything sweeter than verse 2, "Let your soul be at rest concerning your spiritual standing." Now, the passages in this next revelation came to my attention from an experience I had in teaching a class here on campus in Doctrine and Covenants. A young lady, one of the students there, related that she'd been approached by a friend and asked the question, "Do you know who Oliver Granger was?" And as most of us probably would respond, she simply answered, "Well, no, I've never heard of the man." She says, "Ha-ha, that proves Joseph Smith's not a prophet." Now, she was quite surprised at that. But then the friend referred to section 117, so let's us do the same. She referred to verse 12. "And again I say unto you, I remember my servant Oliver Granger. Behold, verily I say unto him that his name shall be had in sacred remembrance from generation to generation, forever and ever, saith the Lord." Now, it appeared obvious to the friend that because the student didn't know who Oliver Granger was, this revelation wasn't true. A closer reading of the passage reveals that more important than any other individual remembering who Oliver Granger is the fact that the Lord indicated that he remembered his servant, Oliver Granger. We need to add his next name here. Let's find out about Oliver Granger and why the Lord said he would hold his name in sacred remembrance forever and ever, from generation to generation. Now, no doubt, through the succeeding generations, the Lord still remembers Oliver and holds his name in sacred remembrance. But again, who was Oliver Granger? One of you may be related to him. In Smith and Scholdahl's Doctrine and Covenants commentary, they tell us a little bit about Oliver Granger here. I'll just read their quick explanation. reading from page 746. Oliver Granger was a man of faith and business ability, two qualities which form a rare combination. Now, this information concerning Oliver Granger makes the following instructions of the Lord clear to understand. Let's look at verse 13. Coming through. Therefore, let him contend earnestly for the redemption of the first presidency of my church, saith the Lord. Now, what has taken place during this time period is that as the trustees of the church, the first presidency was in great debt, dealing with the problems of the bank failure in Kirtland and then moving too far west. This man then, because of his great faith and business sense, is asked to seek to bring the church out of debt. That's going to be his assignment from the Lord, the covenant that he would make. The covenant that Oliver Granger made to put forth his business efforts to work in behalf of the First Presidency led to another blessing. Continue again from Smith and Shodall. At a conference held at Quincy, this would be Quincy, Illinois, May 4th to 6th, 1839, he was appointed to return to Kirtland and take charge of the temple and church there. Now this makes the concluding verses, the revelation, perfectly clear. Let's look at that last verse 16. And again, verily I say unto you, let all my servants in the land of Kirtland remember the Lord their God, and mine house also, to keep and preserve it holy, and to overthrow the money changers in mine own due time, saith the Lord. You may be aware that apostates took over the Kirtland temple as the saints left in what was known as the Kirtland camp. Like Joseph himself had left for his very life. His apostates wanted to take his life along with Brigham and Young and other leaders. So this man, Oliver Granger, is put in charge of the temple there. However, the story of this man and the lessons that we learn from his life is revealed in the sacrifice that he made to become the prophet's business agent. Being a man of sound business sense and reputation, Oliver might have become a wealthy man. Indeed, his name might be more known among the church had he become wealthy and very prominent in the church because of that wealth. Now, the Lord recognizes the opportunity for wealth and the sacrifice of the opportunity for wealth made by his servants. In verse 13, let us continue the verse where we left off of what the Lord tells him. For his sacrifice shall be more sacred unto me than his increase, saith the Lord. And just as he told Oliver Granger that, it's true of other saints today. Throughout the church, there are those who could obtain more wealth, but it might mean that they can't give as much service to the kingdom. But the Lord doesn't count our value by the amount of tithes and offerings that we're able to give in the church. Sometimes service matters. As he says, it's even more sacred to him. And the answers to difficult questions concerning wealth versus service might be found in this revelation. He was a man who paved the way for those who sacrifice worldly wealth to give service to the kingdom. As I can talk on a personal note, I've seen that myself. In determining for education, I spoke to my son about it. At one time, Jim said to me, he says, isn't it too bad you can't teach first grade and get rich? Because he'd been involved in doing some little helping in student teaching down in elementary school. As I visited with my students here on this campus and made them realize that my children who are in first grade mean a lot more to me than a new Walmart. We make sacrifices. I felt the same way as I've seen my own family become quite wealthy. And I'm the oldest in the family. That's just not quite fair, is it? I went through some real struggles until I read how the Lord felt about sacrifice being more sacred to him than increase. And if we do so, I hope that I can have the same blessing. I feel to exclaim as I come to appreciate Oliver Granger as the Lord did. Verse 15, therefore let no man despise my servant, Oliver Granger, but let the blessings of my people be on him forever and ever. Now, let's go to another section too. So you can see each one of these are just little clips of saying, don't pass by these revelations. Section 99, let me go backwards in your Doctrine and Covenants for just a moment. once again, I think section 99 is another revelation that might be classified as lesser known. As you can see again in the first verse or in the heading, that this revelation was a call for John Murdoch to serve a mission. Now, an understanding of the historical background and the individual to whom this revelation was addressed will help us identify the principles for our own life. The section itself elicits a lot of curiosity. Let's just look at verse 1 and see what questions you would have. Behold, thus saith the Lord unto my servant John Murdoch, thou art called to go into the eastern countries, from house to house, from village to village, and from city to city, to proclaim mine everlasting gospel unto the inhabitants thereof, in the midst of persecution and wickedness. Now, when I read this, I do have a curious bent, and I think, I wonder what happened on his mission. It'd be kind of interesting to find out. And not only that, in addition, the Lord gave some unique counsel to John over in verse 6. Now, verily I say unto you that it's not expedient that you should go until your children are provided for and sent up kindly unto the bishop of Zion. Now, that's a long journey. At this time, if you look in the heading section 99, this revelation given through Joseph Smith the prophet to John Murdoch in August of 1832 was in Hiram, Ohio. Zion is down in Independence, Missouri. That's a few hundred miles distance. Now, a study of John Murdoch's life, and have a picture of John in his later years here, and the circumstances that surrounded this revelation illuminate several of the passages here. First is the fact that John Murdoch, at the time of this missionary call, was a widower, left with five children to raise on his own at the death of his wife. Two of the children had been given to the prophet Joseph Smith and Emma for them to raise as their own children. The circumstances behind this arrangement were that John's beloved wife, Julia, had died in giving birth to twins. And about this same time, Emma Smith had also given birth to twins, both of whom died within hours of their birth. Now, John had no relatives who had accepted the gospel. They had relatives, but none that he would trust his children to. And so he took those motherless children to Emma for her to nurse and to raise as her own. The twins, a baby boy and a baby girl, were named Joseph, Joseph Smith, and Julia, after the mother who had died in childbirth. By the time this revelation is given, in August of 1832, the baby Joseph had become the first martyr for the gospel. At the time of the baby's death, Joseph and Emma resided with the John Johnson family down in Hiram, Ohio. And on the evening of March 24th, 1832, a mob came in and dragged Joseph from his room. Now that evening, Emma and Joseph had been up taking turns to care for the near 11-month-old twins who both had the measles. They were seriously ill. And Emma had nursed the children, and then Joseph had pulled out a trundle bed from underneath he and Emma's bed and was laying on the trundle bed with the little boy Joseph laying on his chest. The mob took the prophet but left little Joseph behind to the ravages of the cold that swept into the room. And then a few days later, on March the 29th, due to the effects of the cold and the measles, that not-quite-year-old boy died. John Murdoch, the father, was on a mission at this time. In fact, in his journal, he records what took place when he returned and found out what had happened with his child. He recorded, I arrived in Ohio in the church in the month of June, about 12 months after leaving my children. Arrived there about the 1st of June, found my little son Joseph had died. I'd left my oldest son Oris with Benjamin Bragg, and John with Philo Judd, and Phoebe with Cyrenus Burnett. I had to pay them all full price for keeping my children during my absence, but my daughter was still doing well with brother Joseph, the prophet. Now at this time, Oris was 7 years old, John was 6 years old, and Phoebe was 4 years old. These then were the children whom, in obeying the instructions contained in the revelation, John Murdoch was now to send to Zion to stay with the family of Bishop Edward Partridge. Now, again, referring to John's journal. I then continued with the church, preaching to them and strengthening them and regaining my health till the month of August, when I received the revelation recorded in the Book of Covenants, page 206. Now, this reference also helps us to see how that book was taken care of. This is a facsimile copy of the first edition of a book known as Doctrine in Covenants. However, the revelations were known as the Book of Covenants, and the lectures on faith in the beginning of the book were known as the Book of Doctrine. And so what you had was the Book of Doctrine and the Book of Covenants, or as we came to know it today, the Book of Doctrine and Covenants. And even though we've since then removed the lectures on faith, we've retained the name, the Book of Doctrine and Covenants. So he's referring in page 206, you read, it's this exact revelation that we find in section 99. He says, "At which time I immediately commenced to arrange my business and provide for my children and send them up to the bishop in Zion, which I did by the hand of Brother Caleb Baldwin in September. I gave him $10 a head for carrying up my three eldest children." Sounds like he's sending cattle down there almost, doesn't it? He's coming through here. Now, in addition to clarifying the instructions concerning the children to be sent to Zion, John's journal also gives examples of what I refer to as the doctrine of the law of representation, in which the Lord had called John, as we read here in that first verse, to go from house to house, from village to village, and city to city, to proclaim mine everlasting gospel unto the inhabitants thereof in the midst of persecution and wickedness. We need to continue now, verse 2. And here's the law of representation. "And who receiveth you, receiveth me." Now, if you'll come to verse 4. "And whoso rejecteth you shall be rejected of my Father and his house. And you shall cleanse your feet in the secret places by the way for a testimony against them." Let's see what he recorded that'll help us understand how he literally did that. And I'll move this as we need to. "I then settled my business, and on the 24th of September, I visited Father Clapp's family, preached the gospel to them. They were very unbelieving and hard. I returned to the brethren in Kirtland on the 25th, and on the 27th started, in company with Brother Zebedee Coltrane, and on that day called on Mr. Conning's family, Father Clapp's family, and Benjamin Blitch's family, all unbelieving. Stayed with Brother Kingsbury in Painesville, preached in the evening. He gave us each 75 cents. God bless him. Met with a Dr. Matthews, a very wicked man, and he reviled against us the Book of Mormon and the doctrine we taught. We bore testimony according to the commandment, and the Lord helped us in tending to the ordinance." Now, as we read this, that was fulfilled then, wasn't it? Those who had received John Murdoch and his mission literally had received the Lord. He represented him. Those who rejected him literally had rejected the Lord. And as John indicated, the Lord helped them in attending to the ordinance, which have been that of cleansing feet. Now, as before mentioned, these revelations were given to real people who made real covenants with the Lord to serve him. These revelations profoundly influenced the lives of these people. Now, the Lord was mindful of John Murdoch's faithfulness in keeping the commandments given to him in the revelation. He truly had sacrificed to bring forth the kingdom of God. Now, it's interesting because the placement, or rather the misplacement, of section 99 positions it in a chronological order in context of the persecutions and the expulsion from Jackson County. I don't know if you noticed, but section 100 and section 98 are both given in 1833. For some reason, this was just put in the wrong place. It was given in 1832. We didn't want to redo every reference that guide we help and renumber all the revelations again, so we just left it there in section 99. But in doing that, then, the question came to me in studying it, what happened to those children that were sent down there? Were they there when the saints were driven out of their homes in Jackson County and caused to walk upon that cold and snowy ground that, as Lyman White tells us, you could follow where they walked because their footprints were left with blood in the snow. Were those three children among those? Did their father ever find them again? Because I want to know what influence this revelation had on the unnamed names here. There were three of them. We know their names, Oris, John, and Phoebe. Now, as recorded in the Doctrine and Covenants, the Lord called for an army to march to Missouri known as Zion's Camp. Who do you think was one of the first to volunteer when the Lord asked for volunteers? John Murdoch. He has double reason to get down there, doesn't he? He wants to see what his children are done. He'd sent them down there over a year before. Now, what happened to those children? At the end of the journey, the little army of saints was disbanded. Zion's camp was disbanded at Fishing River. And John recorded the word he received concerning his little daughter Phoebe.
On the 30th of June, 1834, word came to me that my daughter Phoebe was sick nigh unto death of cholera, and Brother A.S. Gilbert, with whom she lived, was dead. I immediately went and took care of her body till July 6th, when the spirit left the body just at the break of day, being 6 years, 3 months, 27 days old.
His journal continues to record the names of two young men, Reed Peck and Henry Rawlings, being blessed as they helped, they said, to assist me. We buried her a little after sunrise in the morning. She was decently laid out, and they dug a grave, and we laid two split shakes in the bottom, one on each side, and laid in some straw and laid ropes on it. Laid two sticks across and covered it. That was her coffin. Now, what may be passed over as insignificant verses in the Doctrine and Covenants should mean a lot more to us as we understand the real people involved and the influence that these real covenants had in their lives. I know I, for one, cannot and will not read of John Murdoch's mission call and the direction to provide for his children by sending them to the bishop in Zion without recognizing the real people involved and their faith and testimony of the restored gospel in the latter days. I also had question and haven't been able to follow completely. I thought, well, what of the influence this had on those children being left by their father? This is a picture of John Riggs Murdoch, the little John. In fact, when his father arrived in Jackson County, he had just turned 8, and he baptized him while he was there. John Riggs Murdoch was faithful all his life. In fact, he's known as making the fastest overland route from St. Louis to Salt Lake City when they were going through with the express route that they had for the church. He served as a stake president down in Beaver and is often referred to in the general conferences of the time as being a faithful man. He was one that his father, he was different than his father because he had lived in Jackson County as a young man. He was one who could speak to the saints for years to come when the others had all passed away. But this little boy who had been 6 had in him the spirit of Zion and spoke warmly and kindly of returning there, and later became a church patriarch. I thought, if nothing else, I needed in the presentation to make sure we don't have questions left in our mind about those children being left behind when the Lord calls a father to service. I found as in nowhere near the same, sending children off. But in leaving my home Sunday after Sunday and wondering how my wife's doing, she serves in the Relief Society presidency at home. We have 7 children, and our oldest is a freshman here at BYU. Youngest is in first grade. I've often worried because I'm not there to take care of them. We have tried to have our family testimony meetings and prayer and scripture study and family home evening. And the great blessing that came, John Riggs Murdoch of our family and my children, they assured me, they said, you know, the Lord's blessed us with a sweet spirit in our home as you've been away, Dad. And my wife continually will tell me as they'll stand and bear testimony of the blessings they're receiving in their life. So just as John Murdoch, let us never not accept the calls. The covenants were real then and they're real now. And the Lord does bless families in both ways. Now, in addition to section 99, that revelation published, John Murdoch was involved in another covenant which the Lord made, which I'd like to refer to, in which he was one of the elders in the school of the prophets at Kirtland. The revelation was known as the olive leaf, section 88 of the Doctrine and Covenants. We're going to look at verse 67. 1688 is one of the more well-known. These verses don't seem to be.
And if your eye be single to my glory, your whole body shall be filled with light, and there shall be no darkness in you. And that body which is filled with light comprehendeth all things. Therefore, sanctify yourselves that your minds might become single to God. And the days will come that you shall see him, for he will unveil his face unto you. And it shall be in his own time, and in his own way, and according to his own will. Remember the great and last promise which I've made unto you.
Now this is the promise of the Lord revealing himself. Now turn over to verse 74, and he'll refer once again to what needs to happen for that blessing to take place.
And I give unto you, who are the first laborers in this last kingdom, a commandment that you assemble yourselves together and organize yourselves, and prepare yourselves, and sanctify yourselves. Yea, purify your hearts and cleanse your hands and your feet before me, that I may make you clean, that I may testify unto your Father and your God and my God, that you are clean from the blood of this wicked generation, that I may fulfill this promise, this great and last promise, which I've made unto you when I will. Now, John Murdoch was one of those who had sacrificed, as we've seen. He is one of those whom the Lord had recognized that he was doing everything he could to be clean from the blood of this wicked generation. And as stated before, these are not idle promises to be passed over lightly. They are real covenants that the Lord made with the saints. A fulfillment of this great and last promise was recorded by John Murdoch in his journal, referring to a prayer meeting held in the Prophet Joseph Smith's quarters at the Newell K. Whitney store in Kirtland. In Ohio, Brother Murdoch wrote, "In one of these meetings, the prophet told us if we could humble ourselves before God and exercise strong faith, we should see the face of the Lord. And about midday, the visions of my mind were opened, and the eyes of my understanding were enlightened. And I saw the form of a man, most lovely. The visage of his face was sound and fair as the sun. His hair was a bright silver gray, curled in most majestic form. His eyes, a keen, penetrating blue, and the skin of his neck, a most beautiful white. And he was covered from the neck to the feet with a loose garment, pure white, whiter than any garment I had ever before seen. His countenance was most penetrating, yet most lovely. And while I was endeavoring to comprehend the whole personage from head to feet, it slipped from me. And the vision was closed up. But it left on my mind the impression of love for months that I never felt before to that degree."
Now, we've looked at and discussed just a few of the lesser revelations of the Doctrine and Covenants and the passages that are there. However, I feel they illustrate the wisdom of including them in the book Doctrine and Covenants, this important book of answers. A few moments of pondering their messages will bring renewed commitment to live the restored gospel and an appreciation for the real people with whom the Lord made real covenants. Understanding the lives and the circumstances of those individuals who are addressed in the revelations brings a greater appreciation of the influence these revelations had in the lives of early church members, as well as the understanding and the strength that I pray that they offer students of the Doctrine and Covenants today. My hope would be that you'll continue. And I also invite that if any of you, as you find inspiring and strengthening passages and experiences in your history and your study, that please share them with me. Because someday we'd like to make these available for everybody. And the book of Doctrine and Covenants will become a book of answers with every section. That's my prayer in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
A set of four video cassettes featuring eight lectures from the 1996 Sperry Symposium, Doctrine and Covenants, A Book of Answers, is available from the BYU Creative Works catalog by calling 1-800-962-8061 or visit us online at the address on your screen. The cost is $29.95 plus shipping and handling.